Thank you very much. Great to be here. Of course, great to be anywhere at my age, but it's great to be here. I am the husband of one wife for 60 years. We have six children, three boys and three girls. It's called Planned Parenthood. It's very difficult to make them come out even like that, as you know. We named all the boys Bible names that begin with D, and the girls R. Ruth, Rhoda, and Rachel, doing fine. David and Daniel, doing fine. Third boy came along, and we said, let's see, another D for a boy from the Bible. Demetrius, Diotrephes, Demas, Devil, we thought of that several times. So we called him Paul. Just dropped the line, make a P out of it. Someone said to my wife, what are you going to call him? And my wife said, we're going to call him Quits. That's what we're going to call him. Eeny, meeny, miny, and Henry didn't want no mo. I'm glad you have a sense of humor, and we're delighted to be sharing with you this morning. You already heard my message. What I'm going to say is just footnotes on what Dr. Farnell said. What a great presentation that was. I think he deserves another hand. Let's give him another hand. That's terrific. You know, there are only two fears in life, the fear of God, which is the beginning of wisdom, and the fear of man, which brings a snare. And you have to decide which fear is going to dominate your life. My topic for this morning is the Bible, are there any errors? The critics say yes. Da Vinci Code said, many have made a trade of delusions and false miracles, deceiving the stupid multitude. That's us. Almost everything our fathers taught us about Christ is false. There are people who, after reading this book, pastors who left their pulpits, there are missionaries who left the mission field after reading the Da Vinci Code. The Jesus Seminar, 70-some men who sit around with colored beads and vote on whether the sayings of Jesus were said by Jesus. They concluded 98% of the total is in doubt. You can only be sure of about 2%. Bart Ehrman went to Moody Bible Institute, Wheaton College. He's now a Christian atheist / agnostic. Said that these New Testament manuscripts copies differ from one another in many thousands of places. These copies differ from each other in so many places, we don't even know how many differences there are. In his book, Misquoting Jesus, which he did many times. I'd like to give you three reasons why the Bible cannot have any errors. Not does not, but cannot have any errors. Reason one, God the Father. Reason two, God the Son. Reason three, God the Holy Spirit. Reason one, God the Father. God cannot err. The Bible is the Word of God. Therefore, the Bible cannot err. A number of years ago, I challenged a New Testament scholar, his name was Clark Pittock, to respond to this logic. He said, which of these do you not believe? Because he said he didn't believe the Bible was without error. He said, well then, do you believe God can't err? Believe the Bible is the Word of God? You either have to deny premise one or premise two, or you have to deny the both of them. God can't err. How do we know? Jesus said, your word is truth, not has truth, but is truth. The psalmist said, the sum of your word is truth. Paul said, let God be true and every man a liar. Isn't it interesting that man is now saying, God lied, and we're telling the truth. Hebrews says, it is impossible for God to lie. Titus 1:2 says, the God who cannot lie. So you can mark that one off your list. God cannot err. The Bible said it, Jesus said it, and we believe it. There are only two alternatives. deny God cannot err or deny the Bible is the word of God, or both. But Jesus said, your word is truth. The sum of your word is truth, and God is true, and God can't lie. And the Bible is the word of God. Jesus said he called them gods unto whom the word of God came, and the scripture cannot be broken. John 10, 34 and 35, there are four phrases in this verse. It's unbreakable, it's the graphe, the writings, it's called the Torah, and the word of God. This is the unbreakable Torah of God, cannot be broken. Laying aside the commandments of God, you hold the traditions of men, making the word of God of none effect, Mark 7 says. Paul said, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's breathed out by God. Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect, he said in Romans 9, 6. Throughout the scripture, over and over again, the Bible is called the word of God. B.B. Warfield, great defender of the faith around 1900, wrote a book on the inspiration of scripture. In it, he has a whole chapter on this point right here. In the left column, what God said. In the right column, when it's quoted in the New Testament, how it's quoted. And then it reverses it. In the left column, what the scripture said, and the right column, what God said. You've heard the phrase, what the Bible says, God says, comes from a comparison of these phrases. They're interchangeable. For example, Genesis 12:3. Now the Lord said to Abram, his name before was converted to Abraham. When that's quoted in Galatians 3:8, it says, the scripture preached to Abraham, saying, well, what the Bible says, God, the scriptures say, and what the scriptures say, God said. Genesis 2:24, it reverses it. In Genesis, it says, the author of Genesis, Moses, said, a man shall not leave his father and mother. But when that's quoted in the New Testament, he, God said, a man shall not leave his father and mother. Well, what Moses said. And what God said, Moses said. Paul put it this way. When you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it, not as the word of men, but as what it really is, the word of God. Therefore, the Bible is the word of God. God cannot err. Hence, the Bible cannot err. Reason number two, God the Son. Whatever the Son of God affirmed as true is true. Jesus affirmed the Bible as the word of God. Therefore, it is true that the Bible is the word of God. Now let's analyze that. Whatever the Son of God affirmed as true is true. Jesus affirmed the Bible as the word of God. Therefore, the Bible is the word of God. But the word of God cannot err. Therefore, the Bible cannot air. Sometime when you have a rainy Saturday afternoon, take out your Bible, get a red letter edition of the Bible where Jesus' words are in red, and just read the four Gospels, the red part. What did Jesus say? And ask yourself one question. What did Jesus think about the Bible? Because it really doesn't matter what Darwin or what the scholars or what the Jesus seminar or the Da Vinci people believe, all it really counts to us as Christians is what Jesus affirmed about the Bible. And I think you'll find something like this. Jesus said the Bible has divine authority. I counted this phrase 90 to 92 times in the New Testament. It is written. That's usually in the perfect tense, which means past action, continuing present in the present. Jesus said the Bible was the written word of God when it came, and it still is the written word of God. Divine authority. He rebuked the Pharisees, the Sadducees. He established his teaching over and over. Jesus affirmed the divine authority of Scripture. Second, he affirmed the Bible was indestructible. In Matthew 5, in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, heaven and earth will pass away, but not a dotting of an I or crossing of a T, we would translate in English. Not the smallest Hebrew letter or the smallest part of the smallest Hebrew letter will pass away until all is fulfilled. It's literally indestructible. Scotsman and Irishman lived next door. Scotsman had built a fence out of stone, 3 foot high and 3 foot wide. His Irish neighbor said to him, "What'd you do that for?" He said, "So when the wind blows it over, it'll be just as tall as it was before." The winds of skepticism and doubt have been blowing on the Bible now for 2,000 years, and it's just as tall as it was before. It still stands as the indestructible Word of God. Jesus said the Bible is unbreakable. You can try and break it, it'll break you. It's literally the unbreakable Word of God. He said it has ultimate supremacy above all human teaching and tradition. And you've exalted your traditions above the Word of God, and the Word of God stands above all your traditions. Jesus said the Bible is historically reliable, and he picked the most disputed passages of the Old Testament to illustrate his point. Jonah and the whale. Is that a whale of a tale, or is it a tale of a whale? Is that historical, or is that hysterical? Jesus said it's historical. And he uses strong contrast in the original language. Just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, even so the Son of Man will be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. There was a girl from the Salvation Army standing on a street corner with her Bible, and a skeptic came by and he said, "You don't believe that, do you?" She said, "Yes, I do. I believe the whole thing." He said, "Well, science has disproven part of it." "Like what?" "Like living in a whale's belly for 3 days and 3 nights. Gastronomical juices, stomach would eat you up. You can't do that. No air to breathe." She said, "If you're talking about Jonah, I believe it's true." The skeptic said, "Well, how do you know it's true?" In her simple face, she said, "When I get to heaven, I'm going to ask Jonah if it's true." The skeptic said, "Well, what if Jonah's not there?" She said, "Then you ask him." The places, one's up and one's down. You know why I believe in Jonah? Jesus said it, and that settles it for me. Jesus said the Bible has scientific accuracy. What's the most disputed part of the Bible? First few chapters, Genesis 1 through 3, in fact, 1 through 11, but 1 through 3. Jesus said that that section of the Bible is the inspired, infallible Word of God. He said, "In the beginning, God made them male and female." Now, in that passage, the creator of the universe describes how we got here. I read Darwin's book, 1859, on the origin of species, and I came to a conclusion. Who's more likely to be right, a 19th century scientist named Charles Darwin, or the eternal creator named Jesus Christ? Who's more likely to know how we got here, the creator or a creature? Jesus said we got here because God made us male and female. And furthermore, he said in John 3:12, "If you don't believe me when I speak of earthly things, how are you going to believe me when I speak of heavenly things? If you don't believe me when I speak of things you can test empirically, how are you going to believe me when I speak of heavenly things that you can't test empirically?" Jesus said the Bible is factually inerrant. He stuck his bony finger right in the Sadducees' nose. They didn't believe in the resurrection or angels or spirit. That's why they were sad, you see. And Jesus put his finger right in their nose, and he said, "You do err. You're wrong." Not very tactful, but I'm sure they got the point. He said, "You do err, not knowing the scriptures or the power of God. Thy word is truth." It doesn't have truth, it is truth. Jesus affirmed the Bible was the divinely authoritative, indestructible, unbreakable, ultimately supreme, historically reliable, scientifically accurate, and factually inerrant Word of God. Jesus said it, I believe it, and that settles it for me. In fact, it doesn't matter whether you believe it or not, it still settles it. As Jesus said it. Here's a painful dilemma for the critics. If Jesus is the Son of God, then the Bible is the Word of God. And if the Bible is not the Word of God, then Jesus is not the Son of God. Because how could he be the Son of God when he erred on some essential teaching, like where did the Bible come from? Now, here's a bad argument you sometimes hear from critics. The Bible is the words of human beings. Human beings err. Therefore, the Bible errs. Sounds like a good argument, but there's a problem. Human beings err won't do it. You would have to say, to make that valid, that human beings always err. The Bible is a book written by human beings, therefore the Bible errs. You say, you're going to tell me that fallible human beings can write an infallible book? Yes, I'm going to tell you that fallible human beings can write an infallible book if an infallible God is guiding their hand when they do it. 2 Peter 1:20 and 21, the God who cannot err guided human beings who could err so that they would not err when they wrote the scriptures which cannot err. How could God do that? God can draw a straight line with a crooked stick. You can draw a straight line with a crooked stick. And the God who is infallible took fallible human men, breathed on them. Jesus said, the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatever I've said to you. John 14:26. I'm often asked by people, how could the disciples, 20 or 30, or some people say 40 years after the time of Jesus, remember word for word everything he said? That's not credible. It's not credible unless you remember two things. Even human beings can write books that have no errors in them. There are math books that have no errors in them. There are phone books that have every number right. Human beings can write books that have no error in them. And a human being guided by the Holy Spirit who can't err could easily produce a book that does not err. Second, I can remember word for word jokes I heard in 1950. That's about 64 years ago. Here's one. Did you hear about the cross-eyed school teacher who couldn't see eye to eye with her pupils? She was so cross-eyed that when she cried, the tears ran down her back. And they took her to the doctor and found out she had bacteria. Now, I remember that stupid joke 64 years, word for word. If I could remember a stupid joke for 64 years, how about the apostles who lived with the Son of God for 3.5 years, who left an impact upon their lives that changed the world? Peter said, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Didn't come from no human being sat down and said, I'm going to write an inspired book today. No. Prophecy came not by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Luke said, God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. Now, here's a good analogy. The living word and the written word, the Savior and the Scripture. The living word has a divine nature, and the Scriptures have a divine side to them. The living word has a human nature, Jesus did, and the Bible was written by human beings. But the person of Christ, one person, has both of these natures, and the propositions of Scripture have both of these natures, divine and human, in one. Jesus was without sin, and the Bible is without error. Now, I say that's a good analogy. It's not a perfect analogy, but it is a good analogy. Why? Well, Jesus was without sin, Hebrews 4. He had no sin. He was without blemish or defect. He's righteous and he's pure. Likewise, the Bible is God-breathed, out of the mouth of God, perfect, same word for without blemish or spot, used of the Passover lamb, is flawless and cannot be broken. Of course, there are differences. The Bible is not God, and the Bible should not be worshipped. We grant the differences. However, in an analogy, there has to be something that's the same. Here's what's the same. Both are the Word of God, and so the Word of God cannot err. The Scripture is the Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God. The Scripture has two natures. The Bible has two natures, and it cannot err in either case. Here's another bad argument that you hear. To speak with humans, God must accommodate himself to our language. After all, he's infinite, we're finite. He must accommodate himself to our language. But there are errors in our language. We have errant language. All of culture has errors. Hence, God errs in accommodation, and he has to accommodate himself in order to speak in the Bible in our language. Now, the fallacy of this. God adapts to our finitude, but he never accommodates to our errors. The error of the accommodation theory is that it assumes in order to adapt, you have to accommodate. Not true. Illustration. Suppose a 3 or 4 year old says to their mother, "Where do babies come from?" And she says, "Storks bring them." Well, that's accommodation to error. In case you haven't heard, storks don't bring babies. Well, maybe the mother says, "Came from mommy's tummy." That's adaptation to finitude. That's true, but it's not the whole story. A little later, the child may ask, "How did the baby get in mother's tummy?" And in order to accommodate, or rather adapt to finitude, the mother says, "Daddy placed a seed there." Oh, that'll satisfy maybe for another year, until they come back and say, "How did the seed get there?" I'll tell you after the service. That's what's called progressive revelation. Came from mother's tummy, seed there, daddy placed the seed, and the rest of the revelation. Nowhere does the Bible tell stork stories. It does not accommodate to human error. It adapts to human finitude. Reason number three. God the Holy Spirit, the logic of the argument. The Spirit of truth cannot utter error. The Bible is the utterance of the Spirit of truth. Therefore, the Bible cannot err. Now, we know from Scripture, David on his deathbed, 2 Samuel 23:2, said, "The Spirit of the Lord spoke by me, and his word was on my tongue." Here's a beautiful illustration of the divine and human. Spirit of the Lord spoke by me, his word on my tongue. So my tongue, my language, my culture came out, but it came from him. It is written, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God," Matthew 4:4. Every word of the Bible proceeded out of the mouth of God. He's the ultimate source, the primary cause. The human authors are the secondary cause. They're the means through which it came to us. How is it when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth, not just some, but all truth, not in words, get this, which man's wisdom teaches, but in words, inspired words, which the Holy Spirit teaches. 1 Corinthians 2:13. Yes, they are Holy Spirit taught words. They are revealed words. Propositional revelation comes from the God of revelation. All scripture is given with the inspiration of God. Conclusion, the Bible can't err because the Bible is the Word of God, and God can't err, therefore the Bible cannot err. Third reason the Bible can't err, the first reason, God the Father can't err. Second reason, God the Son can't err. Third reason, God the Holy Spirit cannot err. Therefore, get this, an attack on the Bible is an attack upon the authenticity of God the Father. It's an attack upon the authenticity of the Father, the authority of God the Son, and the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Now, the reason I put it this way is because I'm trying to avoid a very foolish thing that I often hear people say. And that is, what difference does it make if there's a tiny little error here or there in the Bible? Maybe in geography or history. It doesn't really make any difference, does it? Aren't we making mountains out of molehills? My answer to that is, what difference does it make if we have the authenticity of God the Father challenged, or the authority of God the Son, or the ministry of the Holy Spirit? Or to put it another way, you will hear people say, there are essential matters in the Bible, and then there are peripheral matters. And the essential matters are what is really inspired, and the peripheral matters, it doesn't matter if there are mistakes in peripheral matters. Question. Is God all-knowing? Does God know everything? Is he omniscient? The answer to that in the Bible is yes. Okay? Then my question is this, how many mistakes can an omniscient mind make? How many mistakes can an omniscient mind make in geography? Zero. History? Zero. Psychology? Zero. An omniscient mind cannot make mistakes in anything because it's all-knowing. If the Bible is the Word of God, there can't be any mistakes in it. If there are, we've denied the authenticity of the Father, the authority of the Son, and the ministry of the Holy Spirit. In short, to say there is one error anywhere in the Bible is an all-out attack on the triune God. That, to me, is very important. I don't know how many of you have been to Toccoa Falls, Georgia, but an hour north of Atlanta, there's a little Christian college there nestled in the valley. Above it is a beautiful waterfall, and beyond that, there's a dam which the Army Corps of Engineers assured them that that minor crack in the dam was not significant. One day, the dam broke, and the water swept that whole school down stream. Some 60 people were killed and others injured, and there's a plaque there. You can read it for yourself on the campus of that school. Question. Suppose we interview some survivors from that tragic event, and you say, is it dangerous to live downstream from a cracked dam? Some lost their mother, some lost their father, some lost their children. Is it dangerous to live downstream from a cracked dam? And we all know the answer. Dr. Farnell told us about the cracks in the dam. The minor little errors in peripheral matters here or there, no big deal. Before we know it, the floodwaters of skepticism, agnosticism, and atheism will sweep evangelical Christianity downstream. St. Augustine put it best. If we are perplexed by any apparent contradiction in Scripture, it's not allowable to say, you got four choices, it is not allowable to say, the author of this book is mistaken. God Almighty doesn't make any mistakes. So the author of this book didn't make any mistakes. You got three choices left. The manuscript is faulty. The translation is wrong. Or you have not understood. But you must not, you cannot say, God Almighty made a mistake, and the Scriptures are the Word of God. Here's a helpful comparison. The study of science and the study of the Bible. When you study science, there are many difficulties. Scientists can't explain everything. At one time, they couldn't explain the bumblebee, how the bumblebee could fly. Body's too big, wings are too small. But it flew. And they kept studying and studying and studying to try and figure it out. Now, when we study Scripture, we come upon many difficulties. I wrote a book that has 800 of them in it. Many, many difficulties. We do the same thing the scientist does. We say, I don't know how to explain it, but I'm going to keep studying until I do. The scientist assumes there's an explanation, and he keeps studying, and his diligence is paid off because they discovered a little power pack on a bumblebee that makes the wings go at tremendous speeds to overcome the aerodynamic difficulties. And I commend to you that those who study Scripture run into many difficulties, and we assume there's an explanation, and it's a reasonable assumption. The God of special revelation can't err. The God of general revelation doesn't err either. Not many are explained. At one time, we couldn't explain tornadoes, hurricanes, earthquakes, bumblebees, tsunamis. Now we can. At one time, we couldn't explain how Moses could write when there was no writing in his day. Now we know writing goes back a couple thousand years before Moses. One time, we couldn't explain where the Hittites came from, mentioned in the Bible, but nowhere else in history. Now we have the whole Hittite library in Turkey. Many are explained. What do scientists do when they can't explain some so-called errors of the Bible? They continue to do research. What do Bible students do? They throw it out and become Bart Ehrman, you know. No, we continue to do research. And I'll show you how to explain Bart Ehrman's problem in a moment. The Bible does not err, but the critics do err. Here's an error. Cain married a wife and had children, Genesis 4. But there were no women to marry. There was Adam and Eve and Cain. Abel was dead. So where do you get a wife? eHarmony.com. Notice, it's the error of overlooking the evidence. The days of Adam and Eve after he fathered Seth were 800 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Do you know how many kids you can have in 800 years? A pile of kids. He didn't start until he was 130 with Seth. And he had children for 800 years. Well, my wife and I had 6 children in 8 years. In 800 years, we would have had 600 children. It's a lot of kids. Adam and Eve, Cain had plenty of people to marry, believe me. They're of misinterpreting Genesis 1:1. The problem, Genesis says the sun was not made until the fourth day, yet there was evening and morning light from the first day. You find this in almost all the books by skeptics and Muslims, too. First, there was light on the first day when God said, let there be light. And there was morning on the first day, but he called it the first day and called the morning day and the evening night. Second, there was light for the first day, but the light holders, the sun, moon, and stars, did not become visible until the fourth day, just as we can see that it's daytime on a foggy day, even though we cannot see the sun. So they couldn't see the sun and the moon and the stars for the first days, but it became visible on the fourth day, but the light from it was coming through. Problem, Genesis 1 and 2 give two contradictory creation accounts. Well, first of all, they're not contradictory, but complementary. Genesis 1 gives the outline and chronological order, showing the creation of animals. Genesis 2 gives a more topical and detailed account leading up to the naming of the animals. In Genesis 1, the animals are created before man. Genesis 2, they are named, not created, after man was created. Does not say they were created after man. It simply says Adam named the animals which God had already created. No contradiction at all. Another example of the critics confusing our fallible interpretation with God's infallible revelation. The Bible cannot be wrong, but our interpretations of it can be wrong. Now, I've been wrong at least three times about the Genesis, the sons of God of Genesis 6. Are they angels? Are they the line of Seth? Were they great men of old? Were they demon-possessed people? There are four views. I've held all four views in the last 50 years. I had to be wrong three times. May be wrong now. The Bible is infallible, but our interpretations are not infallible. God's revelation in nature and God's revelation in Scripture have no conflict. The facts of science and the facts of Scripture coalesce. Where the conflict comes are views of scientists about those facts and views of theologians about the Scripture. For example, theologians look at those same facts, and many theologians have said the earth was square because of it. The earth is flat. And creation is a teaching that flows from it. The views of scientists, some look at it, they say evolution occurred. The earth is round. Now, there's a conflict there. Those both can't be evolution and creation, can't be round earth and square earth. Somebody's wrong. Now, I commend to you that in some cases, the scientists are wrong. In some cases, Christians are wrong. Christians are wrong in assuming the earth was square. Christians believed that for years and years, that the earth was flat. They were wrong. And scientific evidence proved that they were wrong. I commend you also that evolution is wrong and that the evidence is on our side. The question is not whether there's general revelation and special revelation and whether there's a conflict. The question is whose interpretation of it is correct. Error of assuming that a partial report is a false one. Here's an example, the inscription on the cross. You would think something as simple as the inscription on the cross would be the same in all four Gospels. Matthew says, this is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Mark says, the King of the Jews. Luke says, this is the King of the Jews. And John said, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Four different ways. But notice, a complete statement undoubtedly said, this is Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Notice also that each gospel has the essential part of it, the King of the Jews. All together gives the whole statement. It's not an error. An incomplete statement is not an error. Error of assuming that divergent accounts are false ones. Matthew says there was one angel at the tomb after the resurrection. John says there were two angels at the tomb. Well, that's a flat contradiction. John Wenham, great English scholar, New Testament scholar, was staying at our house during the Inerrancy Conference of the 1970s, and he said to me, you know, there's an infallible mathematical principle that explains this. I said, what, John? He said, you know, wherever there are two, there's always one. Never fails. Matthew did not say there was only one angel there at the same time and place there were two. Matthew said there was one, and John said there were two, and where there are two, there's always one. Example two. Matthew 27 says, Judas hanged himself. Acts 1 says, falling headlong, he burst open in the middle and all his entrails gushed out. Not too good just before lunch, but there it is. Resolution. Sometime after hanging himself, to hang yourself, you got to do it above the ground. If your feet are underground, it's not going to work. Sometime after hanging himself, his body fell to the ground, broke open, and his entrails gushed out. Nothing contradictory about it at all. The error of forgetting the Bible uses non-technical everyday language. The Bible was written for the common man in the common language. It uses everyday observational language. There's nothing unscientific about it. It's merely pre-scientific. If it were written in scientific language, 2,000 years before there was modern science, it wouldn't make sense for 2,000 years. Illustration. It speaks of the sun standing still, Joshua 10:12. That's no problem. It speaks of the sun rising. Every day, in every major city in our country, a scientist says this. Sunrise this morning, 6 o'clock. Sunset tonight. It's not a sunrise or sunset, but he's a scientist. He's called a meteorologist, and he's using everyday language that we use. In fact, you never heard a scientist say this to his wife. Honey, look at the beautiful Earth rotation. Says, honey, look at the beautiful sunset. Error forgetting that only the original text, not every copy of Scripture, is without error. There are many errors in the copies. Ahaziah was 42 years old in 2 Chronicles 22:2, when he began to reign. And Ahaziah was 22 years old in 2 Kings. Now that's an error in the King James Version. Look it up in your King James and you'll see. The same king, same father, same grandfather, same son, same time period. Can't be both 42 and 22. Solomon had 40,000 stalls for his horses in 1 Kings, and he had 4,000 stalls in 2 Chronicles. Now, that's the kind of error you like on your paycheck. An extra zero here or there doesn't hurt anything, right? Note several important things. These errors are found only in copies. No one ever found an original text with errors in it. You say, well, we don't have any original text. That doesn't matter. We could. In principle, they're discoverable. We're getting very close. These errors are found only in copies. No one has ever found an original text with an error in it. Secondly, they're rare. There aren't hundreds of these. There are hands full of them. And finally, they don't affect any doctrine of Scripture. Every one of the fundamentals of the faith is true apart from that because they don't affect any doctrine of Holy Writ. And we usually know which one is correct by the context. For example, Ahaziah wasn't 42, he would have been older than his dad, which is a neat trick if you can pull it, but hard to pull. We usually know which one is correct. What if you receive this message? Suppose somebody texts you this message. You have won $10 million. Is there anyone here who would not collect their money? You got my point. Look at the error. How do you know that's a U? Well, because the pound sign was obviously a mistake. Should have been an O. It meant you. It meant me. It meant $10 million. And if you received a message like this, then you would be what? Absolutely sure. In fact, the more errors you get, the more sure you are. Because every time you get an error, you get a confirmation of every other letter. So you get more confirmed by getting more errors. Note, even with mistakes, 100% of the message comes through. Even though the scribes made some mistakes, 100% of the message comes through. The more errors, the more sure you are of the message. The Bible has many less copyist errors than that message does. You have won $10 million. Error of taking a text out of context. Now that's literally taking a text out of a context. There is no God. Yeah, but you jerked it right out of the context. The fool said it is hard. I don't think we've been fair to atheists. We need an atheist national holiday, April 1st. The fool said in his heart, there is no God. It's the context. Now here's one. The son of the founder of Fuller Seminary, Dan Fuller, used this to conclude that the Bible has errors in and to give up his belief in inerrancy, which his father held, which even the radio station had it in their doctrinal statement and the seminary had it in his doctrinal statement till they jerked it out in the 70s. The mustard seed is the smallest of all seeds. Ah, the critic says. Dan Fuller said. Science proves that the orchid seed is the smallest seed. Bible can't be true because it makes a scientific error response. Context, context, context. But the mustard seed was literally the smallest one, quote, which a man took and sowed in his field. The first century peasant farmer had no smaller seed than the mustard seed. And he took that and sowed it in his field, literally as the Bible says. To take it out of context and make it about all seeds in the whole universe is not to make the Bible err, it's to make you, the interpreter of the Bible, err. Error of the failure to recognize different ways to designate the same thing. Now, this is a very important one because David Farnell mentioned about a scholar in his presentation, gave us a picture of him, who takes this to be a contradiction in the Gospels. Mark 14 says, on the first day of unleavened bread, when they, the Jews, sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him, where will we have to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover? So this was Thursday, and Passover meal was on Friday when Jesus was crucified. Problem. John 19 says, now it was on the day of the preparation of the Passover, it was about the sixth hour, that he, Pilate, said to the Jews, behold your king. This would seem to indicate that Jesus was crucified on Thursday when they were preparing for the Passover. That said, Mike Lacona, is it contradiction in the Bible? But don't sweat it. Don't sweat it. After all, the Bible is written in Greco-Roman genre, and that's the way they did it. You could have errors in there. He quotes Gundry, quotes Plato's, Socrates, I'm sorry, Aristotle's book on poetics that says that in poetry, you can have contradictions. Problem, the Bible is not poetry. The Bible is history here. And you cannot have a contradiction in the Bible and it still be inspired. Response, preparation is a word used for Friday in the Bible, the day of preparation for Sabbath or a feast. For example, in the same chapter, 19, in verse 31, it says, since it was the day of preparation, and so the bodies would not remain on the cross until the Sabbath. The Jews asked Pilate for the body. A.T. Robertson, the great Greek scholar, said that is Friday of Passover week, the preparation day before the Sabbath of Passover week. It wasn't Thursday, it was Friday it's referred to. D.A. Carson, a New Testament scholar, says preparation regularly refers to Friday. That is, the preparation of the Sabbath is Friday. Now, Bart Ehrman took this as an error. Even some of our scholars take it as an error. Like Michael Lacona, it's not an error in the Bible. It's an error in their interpretation of the Bible, as many of the great scholars recognized. There are no errors in the Bible, but there are many errors in the critics. They can't even add 39 and 27. I wrote a book with Dr. Tom Howe on 800 of these. We spent 10 years studying all of these alleged contradictions in the Bible and looking for answers to them and put it in this book. After 10 or 20 years of research, guess how many errors we found in the Bible? Zero. Guess how many errors we found in the critics? All of them. All of them. Mark Twain said, it's not the part of the Bible I don't understand that troubles me the most. It's the part of the Bible I do understand that troubles me the most. I've been studying the Bible now, full time, for 64 years, since I was saved in 1950. It's not the part of the Bible I don't understand, and there's a lot of things I don't understand. I just been my devotion's been in Ezekiel recently. Believe me, there are a lot of things in Ezekiel I don't understand. They don't bother me. You know what bothers me? The verses I do understand, like, disciple all nations. How am I doing on that? Not too good. Give me a new verse, Lord. Chances are he's not going to give you a new revelation if you aren't doing too well on the old one. It's not the part of the Bible I don't understand. It's the part I do understand, like, thou shalt not kill. That's clear. We killed 3,000 babies today and yesterday and the day before, and we've killed 55 million since January 22nd, 1972. That bothers me. What did the seven thunders utter? Nobody knows. It says seal it up, so everybody wants to unseal it. God said seal it. I'm not concerned with what the seven thunders uttered. I'm concerned with what the thunderous voice of Mount Sinai uttered when he said, thou shalt not commit adultery. Oops. That's clear. Give me one I don't understand. No, take the ones you do understand. Let's turn the logic right side up. We should not be criticizing the Bible. We should let the Bible criticize us. Now you can go through your life looking for little errors in the Bible and die a miserable person and go to a Christless eternity. Or you can let the Bible speak to you and change your life, become a believer, and be with Christ forever. Which are you going to decide to do? Criticize the Bible or let the Bible criticize you? Hebrews 4:12 puts it this way, for the word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And is a discerner, literally a critic, of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Open the word of God, ask God, search me, O God, and know me. Try me, see these wicked ways that be in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. God gave his word not so we could spend our life critiquing it, so we could spend our life with it critiquing us. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for your word. Unbreakable, infallible, imperishable, eternal, forever settled in heaven. Grass withers, the flower fades, but your word stands forever. On the table back there, you'll see some stuff. There's one called the Seminary in the Box or the Seminary on the Go. If you can't go to seminary, seminary can come to you. Get this. Here's another one, Veritas Institute of Christian Apologetics. Get a diploma right from your house. God has raised up a seminary here in Southern California, fully accredited in a great new facility. Just across the road here, with students right in the middle of 3 million people, and he didn't do it for nothing. He did it so that they could take advantage of it. If you're one of them, and I assume you live in the Inland Empire here or close to it, you need to take advantage of that. My teacher in Bible school said this, get all you can all you get, and sit on the lid. That's good.